Thank you very much indeed for the invitation. And I manage dizzy patients with pleasure, especially if you know something about it. It's very easy to diagnose the different vertigo syndromes just by careful history taking. It's very similar to headaches. So talk to your patients, and then most cases are clear within 5 to 10 minutes. Second is that the spontaneous cause of vestibular disorders is, in most cases, it's benign. And you can treat most vestibular disorders. But, and this is the most important message today, not with a single drug. If you have different disorders, of course you need different drugs. So there is no single drug to treat dizzy patients other than symptomatic relief of nausea like a headache pill. But this is just symptomatic treatment. It's not causal treatment. History taking means the two most important things are that you ask what the type of vertigo of the vertigo attack is, and whether it's rotational or whether it's postural imbalance or whether it's lightheadedness. And the second feature is what the duration is of a dizzy attack. Any examples for rotational vertigo? Any disorders which cause attacks with rotational vertigo?
Meniere's disease,
of course. Vestibular neuritis. And another one? Benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. These are the three most important. What about a postural imbalance as a leading symptom? Vestibular disorder, bilateral vestibular failure, and most important, somatoform postural, phobic postural vertigo, which is the second commonest cause of vertigo. If it comes to the duration of vertigo attacks, do you know any example of vertigo attacks that last seconds to minutes? Transient ischemic attacks, this is correct, although monosymptomatic transient ischemic attacks are very rarely causes for vertigo. Then you have also brainstem symptoms or so. But transient ischemic attacks, okay, if they come with some brainstem symptoms. Another, seconds. BPPV, of course. The clot needs seconds to reach the lowermost part of the semicircular canal. And then there's another one. If you are not familiar with that, this is a take-home message, which is very important. Neurovascular cross-compression, vestibular paroxysmia. And this is in analogy to trigeminal neuralgia. This is often characterized by many short spells. These are the 10 most common causes of vertigo in our dizziness unit. BPPV accounts for about 18%. Phobic postural vertigo, very frequent. Central vestibular vertigo, that's a number of disorders, mainly with lacunar infarctions or MS plugs along vestibular pathways. I'm not talking about that. Basilar or vestibular migraine, very common. Vestibular migraine is the most common cause of spontaneous episodic vertigo. Very important. And two-thirds of them have also headache or headache attacks. In one-third, vestibular migraine manifests without headache. So most frequent, and the duration can be from minutes to days, mostly hours. Then, of course, Meniere's disease. Maybe it's underdiagnosed. Vestibular neuritis, bilateral vestibulopathy, vestibular paroxysmia, and as you see here, we have seen 293 patients with vestibular paroxysmia. It's really frequent. And you have to have this diagnosis in your personal spectrum. Otherwise, these patients, they go from doctor to doctor because nobody knows. And perilymph fistulas, we don't see that many. The ENT people do more. That's a typical labyrinthine disease, especially the one discovered by Lloyd Minor, the anterior canal dehiscence syndrome, which manifests with Valsalva maneuvers and loud sounds. 2% of us have a thin roof of the thin bony roof of the anterior canal, and during a Valsalva maneuver, this can break and then cause this syndrome. Type of vertigo, and you named them all: Meniere's, vestibular neuritis, BPPV, postural imbalance, vestibulopathy, central disorders, and somatoform. And this is a large group of vestibular and non-vestibular disorders. Duration of vertigo, very important. And seconds to minutes, BPPV, vestibular paroxysmia, and perilymph fistula. Meniere's attacks usually last hours. They do not last minutes. They can manifest with vestibular drop attacks. But if the typical Meniere's attack lasts hours, and vestibular migraine usually lasts minutes to hours. Familial episodic ataxia type 2, also hours. Vestibular neuritis always lasts days, very important. There is no vestibular neuritis which lasts for 3 hours or so. You need days and then it goes down. And Cogan syndrome and Wallenberg, which vestibular disease with rotational vertigo lasts 4 weeks? Very important. There is no rotational vertigo which lasts for months or weeks. If so, it's psychogenic. And there is no rotational vertigo without an associated spontaneous nystagmus. So if a patient says, just now I have rotational vertigo and the eyes are just still, there is no rotational vertigo. Very important. Triggers are important. Vestibular neuritis and Meniere's, they require no trigger. Bilateral vestibulopathy, you have to move your head or to walk. Same is true for phobic postural vertigo. Head position changes. For BPPV, you have to change your head position relative to the gravitational vector. For vestibular paroxysmia, you can induce or modulate attacks just by rotating your head about a vertical axis. So no change of head position relative to gravity. Very important to distinguish between the two. And perilymph fistulas, you know, and certain social situations, phobic postural vertigo or panic attacks. There are three types of peripheral vestibular disorders with typical signs and symptoms you should know. This is very helpful for your clinical practice. First, bilateral vestibular failure. There is no vertigo with the head still because there's no vestibular input. But as soon as you move your head, then there is oscillopsia, involuntary movement of the visual scene on the retina because the VOR doesn't work. So you see wobbling of the images as if you run with a camera. And if you walk in darkness, then you are unstable. Not so if you walk with lights on, because then the visual system can substitute for the vestibular lack. So these people, bilateral vestibular failure people, they do quite well with lights on and uneven ground. But on uneven ground in darkness, they have problems. Unilateral vestibular failure, the prototype is vestibular neuritis, always causes a vestibular tone imbalance. There is a tone from both labyrinths. And if one labyrinth fails, there is a tone imbalance which causes an apparent a body tilt or rotation, a spontaneous nystagmus into the direction of apparent rotation, and a fall towards the lesion because you try to compensate for this apparent tilt. And there are two disorders which are caused by inadequate stimulation of an otherwise intact vestibular system. Two examples for inadequate stimulation of the vestibular system which causes disorders. Very easy, we talked about that. BPPV, there's this clot in the canal, and vestibular paroxysmia. Because of the neurovascular cross-compression, there's demyelination, and then there's aphaptic spreading if the vessel compresses the nerve. And this causes the excitation of the nerve with short attacks like that, no long attacks. Frequent short attacks.
Remember that when, in general, when I move, I have a feeling of instability. It's because what I see is practically always moving when I move.
What happens with this postural vertigo when you're standing still or lying in bed?
When I'm really standing completely still, it's almost totally gone, or I can't perceive it.
How do you perceive your environment when you're walking?
Can experience it when you're taking pictures with a camera while at the same time walking around. When you look at these jittery pictures later, you see the effect of every step. Often you simply have to stop and stand still in order to exactly see what is really there.
After your description so far, I have a rough picture of what is causing your symptoms. It is probably a functional disorder of the organ of balance on both sides. Next, I would like to carefully examine you by clinical and neurological tests, and in doing so, especially check the organs of balance. Please extend both arms in front of you. And then close your eyes. Now put one foot in front of the other and remain standing still. I'll hold you in case you start to fall. Once again, the same. Good. Now let both of your arms simply hang as normal and walk normally straight ahead. Now close your eyes. Turn around and walk straight ahead with your eyes closed. Now open your eyes and continue to walk straight ahead. Turn around. Now try to set one foot before the other and walk in this way. Now close your eyes and continue to walk this way. I'll hold you if you start to fall. Now I'm going to turn your head quickly to the right and then to the left. Try to exactly fixate my nose while I do this. You do this very well.
Sakat. So bilateral vestibular failure, and what we found 2 years ago was that we tested patients with bilateral vestibular failure. We tested spatial memory and navigation and found that people without a functioning vestibular apparatus, they have significant deficits in spatial navigation. It's obviously that you need your vestibular system to give you the coordinates for your internal representation of space. And if this is lost, then you have problems in finding your way. And also, these patients had a hippocampal atrophy by 16.9% as compared to a normal control group. So bilateral vestibular failure also causes deficits in spatial navigation. The etiology, we looked in our patients, 255, and was recently published in Annals. Ototoxic antibiotics are most important. Subsequent Meniere's disease, and the ENT people among you know that the good thing is with Meniere's that within 5 to 10 years, about 80% will no longer have attacks. However, 60% in the same time will develop the same problem on the opposite ear. Another case.
Could you describe your complaints?
They began 5 days ago in the afternoon. I felt dizzy. At first, I thought to myself, well, I do have high blood pressure. Probably that's what it is. Then within 2 hours, it had severely worsened, this dizziness feeling. And above all, an extreme nausea had developed, which led to vomiting. Then in the course of the evening, I noticed that I couldn't fixate anything. And then the images started moving off to the right. At that time, I called the emergency.
Did the images move horizontally to the right?
Yes.
Could you describe how you experienced this dizziness? Was it more a feeling of spinning or falling over to the side or an instability of gait?
Actually, it was a feeling of spinning. However, when I stood up, I did have the feeling that I was falling over. Then I held tight to something and slowly groped my way forward.
To which side did you feel you were falling?
To the right side.
And the feeling of spinning, did you feel that you were spinning or were your surroundings spinning?
No, the surroundings were spinning.
Did you notice anything else? Double images, a sensory disturbance, a feeling of numbness, or a tickling or prickling sensation, like pins and needles?
No, otherwise there was nothing, just the spinning and nausea. Mm.
And how long did this feeling spinning last? It began 5 days ago?
Now I would say that after 3 days, yesterday it was better, clearly better.
What complaints do you have right now? What have you noticed?
I noticed that when I look down, when I abruptly look down, I have problems. And to the left and right, also when I turn my head quickly to the right or left, then I don't feel stable.
Do you still have problems with rapid movements? And when you look down, do you feel dizzy? Or is it only when you
only
move your
when
head
I move
forward?
My eyes downward.
This is a sudden onset rotational vertigo with a tendency to fall, with spontaneous nystagmus, nausea, which lasts for days. Diagnosis? Vestibular neuritis, we all know. Vestibular neuritis is most probably a reactivation of latent herpes simplex virus 1 in the superior part of the vestibular ganglion. The same is true for Bell's palsy and for some cases or some part, we don't know, of sudden hearing loss. 60% of us have latent herpes simplex virus 1 in the cranial nerve ganglia. And this is not that we just once contacted the virus, but it's an ongoing inflammation, as we could show. There are cytokines, activated T lymphocytes. And so vestibular neuritis is a virus disorder, and therefore we have to see how to treat it. And what is different from Bell's palsy, if re-evaluated 100 NC patients 5 to 20 years after vestibular neuritis, and only 2 out of 103 developed a recurrence of vestibular neuritis. This is good to know for the patients that this is not a disorder which will come every year. And 2 out of 103, and in both cases, it was the unaffected ear. So we didn't see a single reoccurrence of vestibular neuritis. And this also means that if there is recurrence in the same ear several times, this is not vestibular neuritis.
Miss Nussle, normally you treat patients here for dizziness and vertigo. Now you're suffering yourself. What are your symptoms right now?
I was doing yoga and did a shoulder stand. I finished and wanted to lie down on the floor. Then I had a very strong attack of dizziness. I immediately noticed a spinning to the left. Then I had a very strong feeling of nausea and also had to vomit.
Was it rotary or postural vertigo?
It was a rotatorish vertigo.
How long did it last?
At that time, it lasted 30 to 40 seconds.
Do you have symptoms when you lie on your back quietly, as now, while sitting or standing?
At rest, the symptoms were completely gone the first time. There was still a slight nausea, but no tendency to vertigo.
BPPV. And let's quickly go through the most important point in BPPV to treat it correctly is the movement, the movement, the treatment movement is in the plane of the affected canal, and usually it's a posterior canal disease. So if it is the right posterior canal, then before the liberatory maneuver, I have to rotate the head 45 degrees to the left. If it is the left canal, I have to do it to the right, to bring the canal into the plane of the movement. And if you treat, then you have to do it in the same plane so that the nose then points downward. If you rotate the head like this, then the canal is that, and the clot cannot leave the canal. So let's follow the steps here. So no problem with head upright, because the clot is adjacent to the cupola but not deflecting it. Precipitating maneuver. Now the clot sediments to the lowermost point, and the nystagmus is rotatory downward in a crescendo decrescendo. You can do this without Francis glasses, because rotational nystagmus cannot be suppressed by fixation. So Francis glasses are nice, but not necessary. And now, this was ampullofugal stimulation, and you have to free the canal by this movement. So the nystagmus should be the same. Now it should beat towards the affected ear, which is now uppermost. And it does, and that means this patient is freed. Because otherwise, if the clot falls back, it's ampullopedal stimulation, then the nystagmus is to the lowermost here. So look on the nystagmus, and if you see this, the patient is cured. There's no, it's not necessary to let him rest or something like that. Just explain him how to repeat the maneuvers if they come again next year or next day. That's a Japanese figure of an otoconial clot in frog's canal. And we did a follow-up also with vestibular with benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. What is your guess? How many relapses are there within 6 to 17 years after a effectively treated BPPV. What is your guess or your experience about? Any figure? Relapses in BPPV?
50%.
50%. 50% and 80% of the 50 within the first year. And more in females, 59%, than in men, 39%, and less in the seventh decade as compared to the sixth decade. Maybe because you do less vigorous head movements the older you become.
So you came to us because of attacks of vertigo. Can you tell us again when they began and what kind of vertigo you had?
Yeah, they began in October 2001, and it was a postural vertigo. And my eyes moved from the right to the left, and the objects around me also spun around a bit.
And how often did it happen?
During the day, it occurred 5 to 10 times, and it always lasted 30 to 40 seconds. Then it was gone.
Was there anything you could do to cause these attacks, or did they simply just take place?
I could trigger them by shaking my head.
And did you experience something else at the same time? For example, did you feel unsteady while standing, or did you sway or fall?
I didn't fall, but I did walk rather lopsided or tilted, and always had to hold onto something.
Can you give us a few examples of when it also occurred, besides when you shook your head?
Yeah, when I tried to do the long jump in gym classes, I always got dizzy when I jumped. And when I bent down to pick something up, or when I stood up real fast.
And what did the other doctors who treated you think the cause was?
Well, the orthopedist thought that something must be pinched. A nerve, and I don't know what the others thought.
Do you still have these attacks?
No, no longer. Now I take medicine.
Vestibular paroxysmia can occur in children. There's a peak in young people, most probably because vascular anomalies. And in the elderly. And it's most important we follow up these patients, and in more than 90% you see, if you do the axial MRI KISS sequence of the eighth nerve, then you see the crossing of the nerve and the vessel, which is usually the anterior inferior cerebellar artery. If you do not see the crossing, then it's unlikely that this is a vestibular paroxysmia. And these are the characteristic features. And you should try carbamazepine. It's very easy. If they have several attacks per day, start with 3 times 200 milligrams carbamazepine, and most of the patients then are, within 1 or 2 days, they are symptom-free. So very helpful. And as I said before, we have seen 200 and so patients with that. If somebody suffers from vertigo, spontaneous vertigo attacks with rotational vertigo since childhood, what is the most probable diagnosis? It's either Meniere's, but this is rare, but this is very typical for vestibular migraine. These are the features we find most helpful. And as I told you before, the most frequent spontaneous episodic vertigo is vestibular migraine. And the 5 or 6 real experts in the world on vertigo, they all agree, they all made the same experience. We had to learn from our patients. And first we started and thought, this is where transient ischemic attacks, and treated them like that. Then we thought it's a kind of mania, but it was not. And finally, we gave beta receptor blockers, and everything was gone. So keep in mind vestibular migraine, and only 60 to 70% are associated with headache. And what is also very important is test eye movements, because 60% of them have some kind of abnormal eye movements, like downbeating nystagmus or saccadic pursuit, and this is very typical. There are two types of drugs, as I said before. One is a vertigo pill, like a headache pill, and this is symptomatic relief of nausea and vomiting. Anti-vertiginous drugs such as dimenhydrinate, scopolamine or benzodiazepines. And there are not many indications for that. And there is no indication to give such a drug longer than 2 to 3 days. And the major indications are vestibular neuritis, for example, as long as people vomit or nauseate. Acute brainstem lesions, let's say Wallenberg syndrome, some of them. Frequent and severe attacks with nausea, BPPV in sensitive patients who vomit after one maneuver, treat them half an hour before, and prevention of motion sickness, but they are all sedatives, so you can't drive a car. Vestibular neuritis, there are three rules. One is anti-vertiginous drugs, day one or day two. But then you should skip it, because vestibular sedatives, they prolong central compensation of the peripheral tone imbalance. So stop the medication and ask the patient to leave the bed and do exercises in order to promote central compensation. Vestibular exercises are very important, and we run a study with Michael Strupp. This was a 2x2 factorial prospective study on 141 patients, where we tested placebo against methylprednisolone, valacyclovir as an antiviral agent, and combination of corticosteroids and valacyclovir. And the only thing we measured was the mean slow phase velocity of calorically induced nystagmus. And then after 1 year, we retested, because the spontaneous cause of vestibular neuritis is such that about 30% of the patients, if they are not treated, they have a unilateral vestibular loss, complete loss. And another 20% have a significant reduction of vestibular function. And as you can see here, the four groups were very similar. They had a difference between the affected and unaffected ear in the mean slow phase velocity of the caloric nystagmus by 78%, all four groups. Placebo, the improvement was 39%, but 62% with corticosteroids. And no further improvement with valacyclovir, which is a bit different to Bell's palsy. But the effect of the combination of valacyclovir and corticosteroids in Bell's palsy is also very minimal. And we think that the virus replication is already at a maximal stage when we come with our treatment on day one or three after vestibular neuritis. But the corticosteroid effect is probably an anti-inflammatory effect, and therefore improves recovery of the nerve. So the therapy of first choice vestibular neuritis is corticosteroids. And vestibular exercises, we could also show that if you do controlled vestibular exercises, then you reach your postural stability as measured by postural sway on a force measuring platform much earlier as if you do no controlled vestibular exercises. Meniere's disease, you all see patients with Meniere's disease, and There may be monosymptomatic forms, and then it's very difficult to establish the diagnosis. It may also happen that Meniere's not only develops vestibular drop attacks at the end stage of the disease, but Meniere's disease can start with vestibular drop attacks. There's a high drops, an imbalance of endolymph production and endolymph resorption, and a distorted labyrinth. And pressure changes in a distorted labyrinth may cause sudden falls via vestibulospinal reflexes, inadequate stimulation of vestibular organs. And when we were treating our patients with a betahistine, with the recommended doses of 3 times 16 milligrams or 3 times 24, and they came back and said, well, I still have 3 attacks per month. Then we started, Michael Stropp started that in about 3 to 4 years ago. We just started to increase the dose and see whether this helps. And much to our surprise, in fact, you can see several things. This is an open trial, and with all limitations you know about. But still, there were 50 patients in this group and 62 in this group here. And we only recruited patients with many attacks per month, 8 to 9 attacks per month. And then we waited for 3 months and started here with treatment, either 3 times 16 milligram or 3 times 48 milligrams. And what you can see is that there is a highly significant improvement of the attacks with high-dose treatment from 4 attacks per month to 1 attack here. And the second thing is that this improvement was continuous over a long treatment time. So treatment we measured after 1 year. And so this is impressed right now, but more important is that we got support from the German Research Foundation to start a large multicenter study on a dose-finding study for betahistine. And but these data are very promising, and what we recommend right now is, depending on the frequency of the attacks, start with the dose you are used to, and if this does not help sufficiently, then try to increase your dose. Gentamicin, we only ask our ENT surgeons, or mostly with vestibular drop attacks, because they are so dangerous. People hurt, have fractures, do not go outside. And what we do is a single dose of 1 to 2 milliliter and then wait for the course. And in most patients, a single dose is enough. In some of them, you have to repeat it after 1 or 3 years because there's partial recovery of the secretory cells. This has been shown in animal experiments. And in some patients, you have to do 2 or 3 if they come back with attacks earlier. Vestibular paroxysmia, we talked about that. Also an open trial. So try carbamazepine in these patients. This is something for the neurologist, but I have to mention it because this is a new principle we found. First, we were able to demonstrate or to image downbeat nystagmus. Acquired downbeat nystagmus is the most frequent acquired nystagmus in neurology. And from animal experiments, one knows that this is mostly due to an insufficiency of inhibitory cerebellar Purkinje cells, which act on the vertical vestibular ocular reflex and on vertical pursuit. And as you see, the patients here have the downward pursuit is saccadic. And what we did in fMRI is we compared a group of normals doing downward pursuit and then subtracted a group of patients with saccadic downward pursuit and found that the patients had a hypometabolism bilaterally in the flocculus. And what we tried was we tried a potassium channel blocker for aminopyridine as a treatment of this disease, because it was shown in animals that aminopyridines support the activity of Purkinje cells. And in fact, we were able to show that this decreases the nystagmus. In this case, the first study was on 17 patients, and 10 of the 17 had a reduction of slow phase velocity by more than 50%. Downbeat nystagmus is distressing because it causes oscillopsia. You can't read. And therefore, treatment, and it's a permanent syndrome. It also is effective on upbeat nystagmus, but this is not as important, since upbeat nystagmus disappears after weeks or months if you get it with multiple sclerosis. But downbeat is usually permanent. And also, it acts on episodic ataxia type 2. And so three disorders and a new therapeutic principle for aminopyridines. They prolong the action potential and thereby improve conduction velocity of the nerves. And in the meantime, we have seen more patients than the four, than the three described here in neurology in 2004. And we are running a study together with our American colleagues on that also. And it's very well tolerated. And I come to the end. Let's summarize. So what we said is, the only drugs which can be used for all vertigo syndromes are vestibular suppressants, but just to give symptomatic relief of nausea and vomiting, mostly in acute vestibular, peripheral vestibular disorders, or for prevention of motion sickness. And anti-epileptic drugs are helpful, especially in vestibular paroxysmia, or in superior oblique myokemia with monocular oscillation, vertical oscillation, and of course in vestibular epilepsy, but vestibular epilepsy is a very rare condition. So if you make tables, then you write it down, but it's not of clinical relevance. Beta receptor blockers for basilar migraine, betahistine for Meniere's disease, a high dose, long-term probably, in cases with frequent attacks which do not respond to regular medication. Antibiotics in the hands of ENT people, ototoxic antibiotics, mainly in Meniere's drop attacks, corticosteroids, vestibular neuritis, aminopyridine as a new principle for downbeat, upbeat, episodic ataxia type 2, and probably some forms of cerebellar degeneration. We are testing this right now. And these are the formulas. And let's see whether we can together find the major indications. Acetazolamid is a treatment for channelopathies, all channelopathies, right. For amino, also now for downbeat episodic ataxia. Baclofen, it's an alternative to downbeat, but doesn't help much. Betahistine, Meniere's. One should use 4-aminopyridine because a low dose causes same effects as higher dose here. Carbamazepine, vestibular paroxysmia, dimenhydrinat, acute vertigo, right gabapentin, alternative, right gentamicin, memantine, alternative to acute, corticosteroids, metoprolol, migraine, paroxetine. I didn't talk about that. In some patients with phobic postural vertigo, we do this. And scopolamine, motion sickness. Valproic acid, alternative to migraine. Excellent. Thank you very much for your attention.